want to present to you one of my dear friends from Amsterdam, who is probably one of the definitely most interesting people that I have met on the topic of what nature can do for us. He has traveled around the world and experienced and tasted many different ways of creating medicine from nature, whether it would be in the jungle or whether it would be in the Alps. And they figured out that many of the, what could I name that, codes, the lingo, has similarities. And as I have seen him the last year a little bit more, he is growing and developing this amazing art with a lot of passion, being a herbalist, being a traveler, as many of us are traveling in this week as well, traveling the other dimensions and other realms, and coming up with amazing, amazing natural solutions for things that we sometimes have to deal with when we are out of balance. So please welcome him with a lot of love that is very classic to Boom, Aldo Hakman.
Thank you, Lex. What a lot of beautiful faces. Thank you all for being here. Amazing. For a talk about plants, our consciousness is clearly growing fast, having you all being here so interested. So yeah, there's a lot to talk about when you talk about medicinal plants. There's so many levels and things, but since this festival is about sacred geometry, which of course pervades everything, I try to explain it from this point of view for today. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Fantastic. Why would God do such a thing, being a word? What would he say? And he said, let there be light, and there was light. And why would he do that? Well, this is a big philosophy, of course, but it's very interesting because it pervades many religions and science, and also my occupation, herbalism. In physics, they found out that this universe consists of different parameters. These parameters are fixed. The intensity of gravity, the speed of light, how time pervades, and there's the cosmological constant, and there's quite some facets that have to be exactly like it is, or this universe would not be able to exist. It would implode, it would explode, it would fly away, it would be one big black hole, or one too hot explosion of things. It would not be able to exist. And they found that some things may only be different 0.001%, or else it wouldn't exist. Other ones only 0.000%. Others even 10^13, which is like 1,000,000,000,000,000,000. And then if you do this one times the other one times the other one times the other one times the other one, the chance for us to be here now is actually zero. Or at least very, very, very close to zero. Then to imagine that all of your ancestors succeeded to survive and reproduce before they died billions of billions of billions and billions of times, not one not succeeding in this, otherwise you wouldn't be here. Now if you add this chance also to this, it becomes even more like zero. Maybe this is more for a talk about thankfulness of being here in life, but it's interesting just to make clear the fact how important these formulas are that make us, that shape this universe, that can create a canvas, a field where things like us, human beings, can be created, can be in existence. So why would we do this? Quite some shamanic traditions, they speak of a reason why we are doing this. They say, it's kind of funny, they say first there was this God, the all-pervading oneness, and it was everything already, and it was good. It didn't need to be anything. It was all perfect. But maybe it was bored from being all alone and all perfect and everything. Maybe bored is not the right word, but I think it's a funny way of saying it. So what did this complete consciousness do? It divided itself in infinite possibilities. So all these infinite possibilities can have a look at themselves. So the oneness at itself. Come back together one day and learn. And each of these infinite things that has arisen, are us, all of us. We're all here to be the exact, unique pureness of us, and this is the biggest gift we can give the universe. Whether it's a bad thing or a good thing, it's not up for us to say. It's up for nobody to say. You can say this interacts in a certain way with this, and this interacts in a certain way with that. But whether it's good or bad is just a matter of duality. So whatever you are, maybe our goal here is to be exactly that who we are. And this may be called health or well-being. Now this, of course, is a difficult thing to exactly be yourself. What is yourself? We are always interacting with everything around us and everything is influencing us. So to go a bit a step back, if you see this universe with all these formulas and parameters as a canvas, first you have the rules, gravity, speed of light, etc. From these rules come certain formulas. If you throw something in the canvas, it will abide by these formulas. Did anybody ever hear of the game of life by any chance? It's very interesting. Download, it's a little, very little program called the Game of Life. It's about a mathematician who was very obsessed about these formulas. And he made like a canvas with few parameters and time. So he kind of mimicked a very simple universe. And it's a thing with a lot of pixels, and you can add a few, and then time starts. And there's simple rules like, hey, if there's one pixel next to me, I'm going to divide into another one. But if there's three, I'm going to do a step away, and if there's four, I'm going to duplicate myself. And whatever you click, you will see in time that the balance appears. There's going to be some kind of harmony. You even see like life form kind of beings in this pixely thing that reproduce themselves and make more. So it's kind of inherent in a field with laws and formulas that something that looks like a living, self-producing, reproducing organism appears. And this is our universe. So underneath an energetic level, underneath this formula, underneath matter, underneath whatever you want to call it, your emotion, your aura, your being, your color, your character, lies one of these formulas. And we as higher beings are a whole mix of these formulas. So you can interpret it as a level of molecules, a level of sound, a level of consciousness. And these are different fields of different people. The physicist would want to know all these formulas. How do they work? What are they? The chemist then kind of takes it one step further. So these formulas, how do they interact with atoms and molecules, etc.? The biologist would go like, okay, these molecules form certain systems and we start to call it life, and they also interact in a certain way. And then you have the doctor who actually says, wow, this matter does a strange thing. It's good or not good, or it makes you unhealthy or healthier. The psychiatrist would look at it from a mental level. But in the end, they're all actually talking about the same thing. How is this harmony functioning in our system? Now, plants are also created of these formulas. And we are all created of the same formulas. And some are more present in us than in other people. Like, you are made of some different formulas than me, but also of many of the same. We have the same structures, we have certain same mind patterns, but also different ones. And so do the plants. And one way of looking at this is seeing it as a song. For me, that's an easy way of looking at it, to see how they interact. So you and me and you and everybody is their kind of unique song, which has a melody, it has chords, it has a scale, and in time this becomes music. And it's a very interesting song. It can be influenced by other songs of you and you and you, of the food we eat, of the air we breathe, of the emotions of other people, and they can create a more interesting song. May we go to the bridge. May we completely change the turnarounds of the chords. May we even transpose a note so we're in a whole different key. But it can still all sound good, and it actually enriches us. But there are also things that do not resonate with what we are, with our unique song. And it can be many things. It can be the toxins in our earth. It can be the ideas of certain people. It can be the idea that society puts on you that you have to be a certain song. And all these things distract you from your own song, and they kind of take away your harmony. And your song gets disrupted. It doesn't sound so harmonious anymore. And it starts very, very finely, on a very fine level. So somewhere a wrong formula might come in. Of course, there's these formulas around all the time. And it's not inherently wrong. It's just wrong relatively to you. And when we're healthy and strong and in our own song, it's too strong for the other ones to really have a big effect if it's not something we need. It's something that doesn't feed us. But since it's so interactive, maybe we ate the wrong stuff. Maybe we have a job that we don't like or a relationship we don't like. It's infinite. And we are weak. We can be weak. And the things come in and they bring us in disharmony. And it starts very, very, very lightly. And when you're very aware, you can feel it. You can feel certain emotions, like, hey, I'm not really there. You start to feel your thought patterns get different. The Talmud says it's very interesting. I have to think. It says, what your thoughts, they become your words. What your words, they become your actions. What your actions, they become your character. What your character, because it becomes your destiny. So this is what happens. The wrong sound comes in. At first it's very mild, and you might ignore it and don't give it any attention. But if you do this too long, it becomes your thought pattern. You think differently, you feel differently, and then you might say different things which you might not actually want to say. You do then, but maybe deep in you don't, and this gives an interaction. And this interaction mirrors your being, and you start to react to that again, because all these people are going to manifest you as being that. And if you continue and continue and continue, you might get sick. And sick is not only having a thing physically that is wrong, of course it's also a mental thing, but it goes much further than that. It is also the reality you create, the destiny that Talmud talks about. So your life just maybe not as funky as it could be. And it all starts there. Luckily, luckily, the plans are very nice songs. Some are very good for us. Some are very good for me, but not for you. Some are very good for you, but not for me. The plans also consist of the same formulas on different levels. They have their sound, they have their smell, they have their character, they have their energetic field, they have their molecules. And they have their own unique source code, which underlies all of that. Now, some shamans, for example, the Shipibo, they work in a very interesting way like that. They also say, yeah, your song is out of tune. So what they do in the ceremony, they try to hear your song, and they sing your song. Because they believe that if you keep repeating singing your song, you might re-resonate in the right way. These patterns you see everywhere, you see them on clothes nowadays, even in the shops. It's kind of amazing. But watch out with wearing them, because they're not your song. They originally painted it on you because they see your pattern, which is your song. This pattern is like the bit code which makes a program, which makes your molecules, which makes your emotion. By tattooing it on your skin, by singing your song, and selecting the right plants that also resonate that song. They give to you, they prepare to you. That's one reason why they do the dietas, because if you get too much songs inside, which is not per se a bad thing, but if you really want to reattune this facet of you, it's good to not eat too much food that has a too strong a song, like spicy food or trippy food, things like coffee and pepper, and they have a strong song. So they eat very mild food, and this one or few or mix of plants, that kind of, help you resonate that part of you again. This is how they heal. And now comes the, so to say, alchemical part. Because how are we using this song of the plant to heal us? So we can also heal us not being sick. We can always raise our consciousness by using plants. And they don't have to be, per se, psychedelic or entheogenic plants. Any small plant can already have gigantic effect on your whole way, how you see life and how you feel and how you resonate and the things you attract, joy in life, people you love, etc., etc. So you have the homeopathy. They really focus on just the energetic level. And on the other end of the spectrum, you have, pharmacology. And they search for one active molecule. In between, you have maybe herbalism that makes a tincture. So it's a whole group of molecules. And a lot of things in between. There's a lot of professions working with plants in different ways. The question is, when do you use what form of what plant? I'm mostly for an extraction where you get all of these facets. You get the energetic imprint, you get the molecules, and you even get like the minerals and the things. A standard alchemical way of extracting, of preparation, is first making a steam distillation, so you get the essential oils. Then you ferment your plant with a sweetener, so it becomes alcoholic. Then you get like a tincture, but the fermentation process also extracts certain molecules and things, and of course information. You filter that. You can do many things with that. It's a whole, I'm spending years to see what all you can do, but let's keep it at this. And then they burn the plant. They calcify it. So they believe the fire is the most cleansing element. So when you burn the plant, all that's left is the cleanest part of it. So they burn it like 3,000 degrees, wash it with water, filter it. So you wash the ashes with water, filter it. And if you dry the water, you get nice clean crystals if you do it right. And then they mix these three parts. Then you have all these levels. Now what would be the advantage of extracting all these levels? Well, on a molecular level, we see that in plants, being a complete song compared to an isolated compound, you can see some very interesting things. For example, there's a plant called Aspirea ulmaria. It's called Aspirea because its seed husk is spiraling. From this plant, they took the first aspirin. Aspirin comes from the name of this plant and the fact that it's a spiraling seed husk. So, yay, that's aspirin. So they isolated, wow, this is the part that stops your pain. Very interesting. It even stops some inflammation. Very interesting. But aspirin can hurt your stomach if you take it too much. Not per se, but it can. And the medicine for this, if you have this problem, gastritis or ulceration in your stomach, is this plant, a tea from this plant. So in this plant where the aspirin comes from is already the antidote for the side effect the aspirin could have had. So it's very interesting to see why you would extract this whole thing. But there's also an advantage in actually making it more and more and more concentrated and more strong. And where the border is, this is more an art than science, you never know. But if you go back to how far you are in the disharmony, is it still a mind thing? Is it already a physical thing? Is it a short infection or is it something chronic you've been carrying around for years? Is it very intense? So if it comes very acute and it's really physically bothering you very strong, then it's good to have an extract focused also very much on the physical because it's going to resonate there more strong. And if it's still just a mind thing, you could go for a more light extract, maybe a tea or maybe an energetic extraction. And to choose that and which one, that's also a bit of an an art or a science, and, but everybody gets their own unique perspective, whether you're doing Chinese medicine or traditional European or shamanism. They each have their own perspective, but they're all true. They're all talking about the same thing. It doesn't really matter what path brings you to that insight. And the insight is never complete. You always learn more, of course. Then there's the thing, of course, we can speak about molecules in the plant and what it's good for and what it's not good for. But actually, we want to find this source code. Now, how do you find this source code? How do you know that her, his or her disbalance is this formula or has to do with that formula or that formula? That also becomes a bit of a balance between art and science. So, for example, everybody knows probably the plant St. John's wort, Hypericum perforatum, and they use it for depression, they say, which is kind of interesting, and they find molecules, hyperforin and different stuff. There are monoamino oxidase inhibitor, which means the serotonin that makes you happy stays longer in your system. Hence, it's an antidepressant. Could be said like that, because, yeah, it does that on a chemical level. But then why does not everybody become happy after taking this plant? And why do even some people react badly on it? It's because on a chemical level it acts like that, but its source code is very different. Now, to give an example of how you could approach a plant to kind of feel and learn from its code. So is St. John's wort, its name already says it, Hypericum perforatum. Hypericum is from the sun. Perforatum means perforated. It blooms normally when the sun is very high, in high summer. Its flower is yellow, very sunny. If you take its leaf and you put it in the light, you see all these little holes. Hence the name perforatum, perforated. And these holes, they let through light. They let in light. If you take the medicine, you burn quicker when you walk in the sun. Somebody with my skin should really watch out taking St. John's wort and walk in the sun. If you make the oil from it and you put it on your skin, you also get a tan very, very quickly. I would burn. Some of you would get a very nice color. So the whole essence of this plant is letting through light, whether it's in its leaf, whether it's the period of blooming, whether it's what happens to your system when you take it. It lets through light. It has a lot of solar energy. That's a very abstract thing, I know, but it is abstract. It is very abstract. It's something you have to kind of feel, and it's nice to combine molecules and all in your theorization process. But then, having this in mind, and you meet somebody, and he or she is down. What can it be? It can be a lack of light. It can be very simple, a winter depression. But it can also be maybe his or her pet died. The pet was a source of light, but it's no longer there. Maybe his or her job was a sort of light for this person, but it's no longer there. And this would be most of the times a good character type to work with St. John's wort. Up till now, is there anybody that has a question? Because already a lot came by. Yes?
How can we know which plants resonate in more harmony with our own song? How can we know that for ourselves?
Very interesting question.
Thank you.
Which is not so easy to answer. But a nice example is, first of all, everybody knows this. So if you take a deer, they did an experiment with taking the child of a deer away from his mom. They didn't do so on purpose. I have to explain, the mom was hunted, and the hunter took the kid, and it got into a place where they take care of the little deer. Mommy deer, their research knows about 29 medicinal plants. Mommy deer only eats these plants when she has a certain ailment. It's not part of her usual food. You can actually see this deer eats that when it's dead, and eats that when it's dead. But baby deer, although haven't seen mom at all, because she was shot very young, knows exactly the same plants. It didn't learn from another big deer or anything. It just knew the same plants. So instinctively, you know what and when to eat. So the trick is more how to forget all your theories and all your ideas and mindsets. Forget my story about the sun and the light and the St. John's wort, because it might only distract. You know. But okay, that's an easy answer. And it's not up for everybody. Although, I used to give herbal courses, walking in nature, and have a group of people that could be very different. Some very into herbal medicine, some very hippie, talking to the trees all the time. We had to, come on, come on. And we had this business guy. He was just interested. And he was very, humble. Because he kind of felt this is completely not my field. He was the most humble of all. Everybody had an idea, an opinion about plants and everything, and some more than others. But he, especially none. He was all open, like, wow, this is a new world to me. I'm so curious. How nice I can join this. And we were walking through the forest. And he says, hey, what's that? And it's not an instinct plant at all, in sense of having big flowers or everything. It just has a... just a green plant, not much different than most of the plants. And say, oh, that's named this and that and that. I thought on purpose not to explain him anything about it. And you see him kind of like, that's not a cool answer. So we're walking along more and more. He said, yeah, I see it again. I said, yay, good. And, and he's again like, oh. So when we finish the walk, or we have a break, I don't exactly remember, we sit down and he comes like, so what is this plant? I said, do you have a liver problem? He said, yes. I said, probably from a certain type of medication, not from alcohol, something. Yeah. I took this thing for the blah, blah, I don't remember, something is hard, which is hard for liver. I said, well, this plant is one of the greatest detoxes of the liver for this kind of substances. I spoke to him in this way. I could also speak energetically to him, but since this is his mindset, I like to speak on a chemical level, so he gets it and vibrates. So I said, this plant cleans the liver, especially when you take this group of molecules. Nah. Wow. If you saw his face, it was like the realization he is still one. He didn't notice. I don't know what was going on in his mind, but you see his face like, wow. Wow. And he was so happy and satisfied, and of course he took home this plant, and I hope it healed him. I haven't seen him anymore, but would have made a better story. So yeah, we know. On the other hand, there's ways of recognizing this code, and in Europe we call this the ruling of signature, of the school of signature. They believe every plant has its signature. So you can either see by shape, as with the St. John's wort, its signature is letting through light. But how to recognize is, yeah, there's many levels. What shape does it have? Does it look like a vein, or does it look like a certain thing? And it's not always like this looks like this, so it's for that. It's more, you know, it's more feeling. It can be a smell, it can be an interaction, it can be anything. This is a whole school. I would love to explain you a lot about this. And even for me, it's still a lot of learning in how they see this, and there's no clear rules. But the more you learn about it, the more you realize in recognizing it. Another way, which is very good, is to always, when you walk out, eat. Don't be afraid. There are very toxic plants, but they're very, 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 very rare. And if they're very toxic, you mostly feel something happening bad in your lip. So, don't. But if you just walk in the forest and you're already kind of open, your mind is clean, and you kind of let the city or whatever your life is behind, and you chew on the leaf, and you feel something. You feel your emotion going a certain way. That's the first thing. You feel, hey, I feel relaxed, or I feel focused, or I feel disassociated. I feel, you know, you can... We are very, very fine instruments. We're very fine. Besides emotional, our tongue, for example, our mouth, our taste is, although we as humans compared to other animals have a very lousy one, it's still very exquisite. It is much, much, much more evolved than whatever analyzing laboratory equipment we have. Much, much more. So we have this whole lab in our mouth. We have receptors for everything. And of course, we didn't get this nice flavor so we can enjoy a three-star dinner. This is not the evolutionary reason why we can taste. We have this taste to do exactly this, to taste what does it do. And this taste gives you the information. So if you empty your mind with all your preconceived things, which you see in the internet now a lot, okay, curcuma is good for everything, so if you eat a kilo a day, you're going to be 1,000 years old. It doesn't work like that. It is a good thing, but maybe this curcuma is exactly not your source code. Could very well be. In Ayurveda, they're a bit more precise in this, but internet is not. So watch out, because you see people and have all these things they read about a lot, and they eat it, everything. And this can also deharmonize you in a certain fact. So everybody has their own perfect herb and formula. And don't let anybody kind of influence you too much. It's not good for you. You know? If you really like it and you feel good, it's good. Simple as that. Does it kind of answer your question? Thank you for the question.
Hi. So going back to the St. John's Wort and how it has its song and it resonates with the sun, I was wondering your opinion on the Bach remedies and how they come from strains of flowers and if there's any truth behind that.
The Bach remedies?
Yes.
Yeah. It was called Bach.
Bach, sorry.
It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. But just to honor him,
yes.
Say his name, right?
Sorry.
No. I didn't mean like that. For
thinking
everybody.
Of the composer.
Yeah, nice composer. Actually, the first thing I learned to work with were Bach remedies. My father is a doctor, the traditional kind, and he turned homeopath. And if I would feel bad, he would give me these drops. And at first I was interested, what do these drops do? And he had ways of putting your acupuncture points and checking your muscles and all these techniques like that. And with these wobbly things and push you if you fall or not. And then this bottle, and he's a very psycho guy. He has all these machines that make magnetic fields and things on your head, and you see it resonating, and very interesting, but a bit for me they really helped. They did. It's very hard to say what they actually do. I haven't been there and how they make it, but I have heard from a colleague of mine that works with them together sometimes that it is very far away from how Bach used to make it, of course. He would collect the flower, and in this coding of your medicine is not only the plant, but your intention. Where did you pick the plant? When and why? And what was your intention while creating it? This is all very important. It all goes into the medicine. And nowadays, I heard they just have a little bit of tincture and they throw it in a gigantic silo of a lot of brandy and water and mix it and hoppa, and it's Bach. But, on the other hand, it is still his lineage. So, whether he's still here or there, or it's just his intention with what he made that project, that will still be alive. So, yeah, I think it's, and from experience too, feeling it and seeing what happens to people, it can be, when selected in the right way, very powerful medicine, yeah. But you can also make your own. You know how to make your own? Okay. Bach remedies are made. Traditionally, Bach collects certain flowers. He puts them on a, it's a simple explanation, but it's a simple process, actually. So you collect the flowers of a certain plant. You put them on a ball of water. You let them float, and you let it on there for 3 hours. And then the energy of the flowers goes in the water, filters it, mixes it with brandy, just to preserve, and here's your stock bottle. And from that you put like one or two or three drops in another bottle, and this is your remedy. So it's a very cheap to make. You can make a lot of money making Bach remedies. Yeah, it's like millions you can make with five flowers. You can try that. Do it again. I personally prefer to leave it 24 hours, not three. Not to say he did a bad thing, but I just like to have give him a whole cycle. Even if it's just my feeling, I don't know. But if it's your feeling, it's going to be better anyway, if it's your feeling. So yeah, if you are in nature and you feel a plant and a thing, you think, wow, this really somehow It attracts me. Don't think further. It just attracts me. Do this technique. Make it. See what it does. Yeah. Another question?
Hello.
Hello.
I heard somewhere that if you take a seed of a plant and put it under your tongue, leave it some time, I don't know, not long, it absorbs your information, or and you then plant a seed, that plant can help you. Is that, does that make any sense?
Yes, this is the Anastasia technique you're talking about, I believe.
I don't know.
It's older than her, but she's the one who kind of made it public. I don't know how to call it. Made everybody know about it. Yes, every step in making a plant, from the seed till the intention when watering it, the intention when harvesting it, it can make anything your medicine, even a poisonous plant, because you are just saturating it with your intention, which is the most powerful thing in the coding. Of course, it would be extra cool if you somehow know which is exactly your perfect plant to work with. Your perfect plant, our perfect plant. Sorry, my English. And then make a selection of that and make this your own medicinal garden.
Can you collaborate about your thoughts and the spirit of the plant? So what is your thought on if you take a plant and you make a medicine out of it? And you make a medicine out of it.
Yes.
What happens to the spirit of the plant?
That's a very good question. Difficult to answer. Like, this is what happens, of course. A whole lot comes in. He was asking, if I remember it right, what happens to the spirit of the plant if you extract it? Or if you make something with it? That was the question, right? Definitely. This is a very important fact he is questioning. What is the spirit? So we have a spirit. First the question, what is that spirit? Is it just a reaction of all these formulas creating a mind? Or is the higher being which makes you a unique thing? That's a whole philosophical thing. But they clearly have, let's call it a character. From their character, I think I can feel their spirit. And they can be very happy, or they can be kind of fuzzy, or anything. It really helps to communicate with the plant. Hey, how you doing? And you see if it reacts happy or not somehow. At least I think I do. Nothing is certain. And it tells you whether it wants to be picked or not. Now the shamans in Suriname, for example, they do this, and if they pick it, they give it a coin. Or orshade, which is a very chemical, ugly almond drink they make. He loves it. They make real ones too, sure, but many times they just give this canned version. And it's just the idea of a trade. So you make a deal with this spirit. Hey, you help me, I help you. And of course, this is an intentional thing. It can be a coin or the orshade. What I personally like to do, if I collect it in the wild, and I learned from a good friend in Austria, actually, how he did that. He always takes away some of the other herbs around it that are too much or inhibiting its growth. Or later comes, takes some seeds and plants the seed for this plant, because we are all being in one big unity. What's the name I'm looking for? Yes, thank you. It's one big symbiosis. And if you only take without giving, it's going to make you maybe even more out of tune. So you always give. And I think this is the most important part of keeping the spirit intact. I feel like this. Then in your extraction, there's all the other parts. Are you going to make it one single molecule? Are you going to keep it a complete thing? But I believe that if you do this part very right and you honor the presence of the spirit, you accept it, then even if you get to the molecule part of it, it's still there. But you might miss a lot of other information that could have been there also. That's my view on it. Can I hear your view on it?
So my view on plants is actually, like, if you look in the totality what's happening, everybody is praying and preaching to up, not to down. For if you look on your body, it's plants is your clothes. If later you're hungry, it's plants feeding you. If you get a rash lying in the different part of some grass, it's a plant that's going to be the medicine. And so there are also plants that can bring you from this reality onto dimensions, and for sure it has a spirit. For me, like seeing people under a tree, they appreciate the tree, but I will sit under the tree and I will make music for the tree, with the tree. For if you cut down this tree, I feel it. So the spirit, yes, even a rock is like, if I'm in Peru and I talk to people around me, they must give me the opportunity, if I'm with them, to stop and talk to a mountain or to give gratitude to a tree. For all has a spirit.
You know, amen.
You're just, your consciousness is just in a soap bubble, and if you take the body away, it's like piercing the soap bubble. And then if you do respect plants and you use it in the way it is supposed to, then, yeah, it takes you to your source. It takes you to takes off your layers, more or less. So, yeah, find yourself to the feet or something and just sit to the plants as psilocybin or plants with DMT. Don't smoke it. Just let you puke from it, for she will work on the level of the body. And then the six other layers of your existence, if you're blessed enough and you have done your homework and your past life cycles and you continue your homework, she cannot bring you from dumb to enlightenment. But she will look, okay, you stopped here with your homework, you found the plant. And guys, it's like a cure, minimal 3 times in a week period, or else it doesn't work.
Thank you very much.
Hey, Aldo.
Yeah.
What's your take on actually not taking the plant, but just having the plant in your proximity and let it work on you through?
Yeah.
Could you share something on that?
Yeah. In the end, especially if you've done your homework, as he just explained us all, and you're pretty open and clean, you don't even have to be, but then you really can see the difference. You don't have to consume the plant. You don't have to make a whole thing out of it. You can even meditate on it. You could call upon its being. You can even, in a ceremony, call upon the being of a plant. Sometimes they come by themselves and say, hey, I want to do something, and they have their songs. So you can learn the song of the plant. By focusing, dieting, taking plant medicine, just taking the medicine and one other plant, and this you do for a long time, until you get it, the plant might show you its song. And this is what it's all about, the song. And once you have the song, you don't need to make anything. You can be there, sing the song of the plant, and it will rewrite the coding, or tune, better word, the coding of the certain person. But this is very high level magic, and going for it. But it's high level magic, and not everybody is very well, everybody's able probably to do it, but to receive it, to make it, to know the song, to have it, it's something I think we can all achieve, and something I would like to achieve. And actually, from some I've learned songs, and there's some that actually come in certain situation, and I sing them. Very interesting. They're very crazy. Like Lavendula. Everybody gets their own interpretation on the song, of course. It's your individual way. How did you see it? But Lavendula once came to show me. It was a free-spirited woman looking 3 directions at the same time, spinning around like that. like a fire tower, like a radar, just seeing everything around. And when something like that's the song of La Fendula, as I interpreted it. Another song. Well, this just came. Maybe another one comes soon. I do have... Okay, let me think.
Alma, you got this. This is so beautiful. And you know what? I want to share something. This is a very special community. And we talk about this very, 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 very high frequency work a lot. We do. But because this somehow this festival is a vortex, you know, you can actually surpass a few levels sometimes. Not for everybody maybe, but it's very possible. So it's good to share this because then we can... already incorporate this in a way, have it in our system. So when we encounter it, we can have this as a memory and activate it. So please share this because it's amazing information.
Well, thank you for that information. I'm very used to slowly going.
There's a reason why it's called boom.
Boom. I have to say, now that I have to find the songs, I can't get one in my mind. There's a Wachuma song I got. It's in Dutch. He has many, 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 many songs. I know a lot of traditional Peruvian ones, but this is a Dutch one. Komt u maar, komt u maar, komt u maar, komt u maar, komt u met ons zingen, doet u met ons mee. Ja, komt u maar, komt u maar, komt u maar, komt u maar, komt u met ons zingen, doet u met ons mee. Kunt u ons vertellen wat wij nog niet begrijpen? Kunt u ons laten zien wat wij moeten weten? Kunt u ons vertellen wat wij nog niet begrijpen? Kunt u ons laten zien wat wij moeten weten? Komt u maar, komt u maar, komt u maar, komt u maar. Komt u met ons zingen, komt u met ons mee. Ja, komt u maar, komt u maar, komt u maar, komt u maar. Komt u met ons zingen, doet u met ons mee. Ja, komt u maar. It's to call the spirit of Wachuma, to invite him into this sacred space. Yeah. One more question.
So I have a question regarding domesticated plants. Do that kill the spirit of the plant or change the code or the molecules? Because I'm trying to relate to what you're talking about. When working in a farm, you have like to harvest. Or when you plant seeds, so.
Interesting question. Certain plants that grow in the garden of the shaman are much more powerful than the ones in the wild. Some can be maybe weaker. So everything is possible. It's like us, if you sit in your house all day long doing nothing, you're weaker than maybe when you're in the wild in your traditional state. A bit could go with plants too, but there's such a nice symbiosis, thanks for reminding the word, between humans and plants that you can give it the things it needs. You can surround it by other plants that have different parts of information so they can make a nice song together. So if you're not monoculturizing it and you're reading your permaculture books and you're doing it and you're mulching and you're mixing and you're blah, but most importantly, you're giving it love and attention. And especially if you start asking it to grow in a certain way, you ask it to grow to be good for a certain thing. You say, hey, wow, you're good for my heart. That's why I grow you. Thank you so much. I will feed you if you can later help me. It's that much of a deal, actually. Although it sounds unspiritual, it is how it is. And then you make a connection with this plant, and it will be stronger even than in the wild, I believe. So that's my view on this. More? Yay, here.
thanks a lot. Somewhere in your story, you also mentioned about you giving courses and stuff. You still do that, or anything where to learn from is very inspirational. So if you can elaborate on that.
Thank you very much. It's very nice to hear. Personally, I got a bit caught up. I was busy with all these plans. I am busy perpetually with all these plans, and some turn up into products which people like, and you have to make more. To make more, you need a bigger pen. For a bigger pen, you need a bigger room. For a bigger room, you need more money. For more money, you need more bookkeeping. Ridiculous. So I got so busy with my job in that sense, producing medicine in this reality, and actually growing along with what the demand is, which got pretty, yeah, got quite something by now, which takes a lot of time, and is actually now at the point where its own success, thank you, is kind of distracting my own song, to be quite honest with all of you. And that's why the time I should spend on these things is not as it should. And at the moment, I'm actually realizing this and thinking, okay, how can I neatly make this in a balanced way so it still exists and everybody's happy and it's still being made, and I can go on with that. And then hopefully very soon, I have time and space for that again. But I'm focusing a bit now on creating a lab again somewhere in, I think, the Alps. I like the Alps. It resonates high. And then invite people, come and work, like a workaway thing or something like that, whatever word, and then help grow and thing. And we make a lot of cool stuff. And you learn and make, and yay, and we have all our song of all of us together, and then.
And maybe you can go online, eh? Because we're a big international community. We come from really all over the place. Share some stuff, like sit in front of a camera. Why not use a little bit of the digital? Huh?
Digital could be nice.
Could be.
Could be nice.
Could be. More questions?
Why is your name so similar to Albert
Hofmann? Well. Yeah, well, well, Albert had a big mission. Since the Swiss created the clock, he had to make something very awesome to, you know, rebalance that. So, try to find you, your identity, with all the information coming now all these days, with the internet and all the streams of healing, and from shamanism to this and this and that and that and that and that and that and that and that. Try to find your own reality and be proud of it and be it, because that's the greatest thing you can do for this universe. And nobody knows besides you actually what that is. And in chemistry, there's a saying, the only failed experiment is a non-documented one. So yeah, maybe meditate on it every now and then. So you have your package of information ready for the big unity. Thank you, everybody, for your patience and focus.
Ladies and gentlemen, give him a lot of love. And look him up. Go find him in the Alps. And if you don't find him in the Alps, I will kick his booty to make sure that we can find him online somehow. Amazing, amazing. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Ciao.